Welcome back to another episode of The Loco Fit Show, where we redefine what healthy means to you. I'm your host, Lauren Conlin, and this week I'm joined by my friend, Taeler Haes. Girl, I'm so happy to have you on the podcast. This is
Me too.
Long time coming. So we've actually known each other for, what'd we decide, 10 years?
A whole decade.
A whole decade.
A whole decade.
Crazy. So we've known each other for 10 years, many different iterations of knowing each other, right? I feel like that literally feels like multi-lives ago, right? Like,
well, because we've had multi-lives in the 10 years. Like,
I know.
100%.
Like, it's so crazy to think of where we are now. So for everybody who maybe doesn't know you or is like knows you a little bit, but kind of like, what does she do? Dive into that. And we're going to have an awesome talk on just kind of like the bullshit around business right now in the space. Not even just business coaching, but business in general, but business coaching as well. So
as you say, and business coaching. Yeah,
and business coaching. So dive into your background a little bit and just kind of the TLDR of what do you do?
The TLDR. Okay. So the short version is that I am a business mentor and consultant for fitness coaches starting from zero all the way up to their first $1 million, right? But in terms of background, and Lauren was saying we have like nine lives in the past decade. So my background and how I met Lauren was I was an investigative TV reporter for about 10 years. And I met Lauren doing a few interviews, and we both worked with Lane Norton at the same time. Fitness background, I am a former powerlifter, bikini competitor as well, fitness coach, and that's kind of morphed into what it is today. So that is the shortened, condensed version of what I do.
Yeah, no, and it's been so great to watch you evolve over these few years, well, 10 years, but really over the past few years, right? And like really find your stride. And I had the pleasure of being at your event for your clients last year, which was so awesome. They were rad. And I'm just stoked to talk about this because as you guys know, if you listen to the podcast or follow me anywhere on social, or have ever talked to me, right? There are often some grievances that I have in the current space. putting it mildly. And I have those grievances like for, I feel like, good reason, right? So first, let's talk about in terms of like just again, business coaching, business landscape, all of that right now. If you're working with someone who is just starting out, right? And everyone is getting bombarded with these messages of what they should be doing, right? What are some of the biggest issues or red flags or misinformation that you're seeing for new coaches who are like, I'm so overwhelmed. Like I keep hearing these messages and they're just like flat out not true. So let's start there.
Okay. So there's a few ways I can take this, right? I think number one, I'll go with where I think you should start and assess yourself. And then what I think you should maybe just remove from what you're listening to. And this is not any advice I give you is not coming from a place of this is my way. It's more so of just what information I think is clouding the arena, because the business coaching space is just as saturated now as the fitness coaching space, and it's only getting more bombarded. Like, I don't know if you ever get advertisements, but the things I see are wild. So, you know, everyone is coming at you with all of their dollars, all of their ad spend. And so anyway, what I would say is if you have never had a client in your life, right? Like, let's say you have a passion for this. Maybe you're your friend's coach for free. Like, you know, that's kind of how I started, right? Like, I didn't have a formal education, but I had been in the space for 10 years before I ever coached anyone, and just had really great mentors along the way. So my fitness knowledge was very informal. And so instead of starting out with the things like websites or logos or any of that, right? Or you need more followers, especially if you're watching Lauren, right? Like Lauren is somebody that got into the space very, very early on when the algorithm was like not a thing, right? And then like I'm a different example where I started my business in 2019, didn't have a ton of followers, still scaled a seven-figure business, totally organic, right? And so I think that we're bombarded with all these flashy new things that you need when in reality, number one, you need to be a damn good coach, get a client, right? Like figure out how to do that. Number two, you need a sales strategy that can be repeatable. Number three, you need a marketing strategy. That is it. Marketing, sales, and delivery is all you need to scale a business. Now, what I want you to not look at is if you see a business coach with a Lamborghini or a Rolex or champagne showers, like I probably would look away unless that is the lifestyle that you want. If you are getting into this space with the intent of just making money, that's where I would say recenter and refocus. Something that I'm not loving in the business coaching space though, is this this idea that you can build this crazy big business, whatever that number looks like to you, with 3 hours a day of effort or minimal effort, or if you just run ads, right? And so I don't push any of my clients to do paid traffic or any of that, right? It was a very long time in my business before we ever dove into paid traffic. And I think bottom line is, people are trying to sell you a false narrative of entrepreneurship, and it's causing people to fail and feel fatigued really early on. So I think that's the biggest sticking point. And one statistic I like to give all the time is, you know, I mean, only 4% of business owners ever reach the $1 million mark. And of the 4% that do, it took them 5 years to do that, right? So I think that if we try a strategy for 30 days and it doesn't work, we're so quick to fail, when in reality, like, you all that are trying to scale businesses, you're entering an arena that 99% of people will never enter. Like, you're entering a space that people don't want to touch, right? It's easier to get a paycheck. It's easier to just walk in and clock in and clock out. And so I hope that after this podcast, you understand that, like, your frustration, your overwhelm, all of that is so normal. And Lauren and I can tell you, we are not immune to it. Like, business is wild. It's a wild ride, but I wouldn't trade it for anything.
I love that one point that you made about the 3 hour workday and that whole notion. And I think that that is truly driving some really bad behaviors, really bad mindset, and also setting people up for failure, because that is very unattainable for most people. Right now, if you are, I think this depends on what type of business you want to be in, right? So I'm not going to sit here and say that every single business in the world could not operate like that, right? Like, there are probably some, like, product-based businesses maybe that you could do that, right? Like, not my field at all. I barely can hit, like, I know my one business and that's about it, right?
Like, but if you're selling something on Etsy, yeah, like, 3 hours a day is probably a lot.
yeah, right? Like, so it's like, okay, could I see maybe something that has, you know, a lot of back-end work, but then once it gets going, it's less. Okay. But when we're talking about service-based business, which is what all coaches are doing, there is never going to be a time, unless you just want to only work with a handful of clients. And that is also super fine, right? If you want to work with a small amount of clients, you will work less. That's great, right? But I think that the promise of work a low amount of hours and make a fuck ton of money is just like, that's just not, I don't think that doesn't track, you know? And I think that if you're getting into it with those reasons, like, that's also the concern, I guess, that I have, is like, if you're getting into a business to help people, right? It's like, and you're already saying that you, like, don't want to really work on it. It's like, or you don't really want to do a lot with them. It's like, well, that's kind of defeating, like, the whole purpose of being in a service-based business, right? Just be in a different kind of business, right? Be in a product forward business or something like that. And I get, obviously, yes, you can charge more money and work with less clients, like, duh, right? So, like, yes, you could work less hours technically if you did that. But again, the promise of this, I think, is what is creating these issues for people, because then they're working, you know, 8, 10, 12 hour days sometimes. And they're like, oh my gosh, I'm failing. So-and-so is doing this. Like, what's wrong with me, right? And then it's just like this whole perpetual loop. And I don't know, I'm sure you probably get a lot of people who have either been, you know, have worked maybe with someone previously who has told them that kind of methodology, or just, like, not even has worked with someone, but, like, they're just seeing these messages constantly, right? Like, would you say that that's really accurate? And then people are probably just coming to you already, like, very fatigued with that message, but don't know what to do.
Yeah, I mean, a few things on that. So number one, if you are more committed to your situationship than your business, we have a problem. Like, if you're more committed to your hobby, then, like, we have a problem, right? So listen, I'm not going to give you the disclaimer of, you know, if you're working a 9-to-5 job, I'm well aware you don't have 8 hours a day to put towards your business. I get that, right? It's not about the time. It's about what you're doing. Because I guarantee you, if I surveyed 10 different coaches that I didn't know that told me they were working 10-hour days, I can promise you only 4 of those hours are probably productive. Like, I can promise you that.
For sure.
But Here's what I don't like. The same people that are promising you these short work days, they've also been removed from their coaching container. So I see these, you know, big name coaches and business coaches that are saying like work less, whatever. And then they're charging, you know, multi five figures to their program with their face on the front. Then you get in expecting to work with that coach and then you don't see them ever. And then you have 12 support coaches that are giving you all different answers. That's why you're frustrated, right? There is no way to scale a business without working. You will never work for anything harder in your entire life than running your business, whatever the hours equate to. But, you know, I frequently have 8 and 9 figure business owners on my podcast or in my network, and not a single one of them is working less than 60, 70 hours a week. And I don't say that to scare any of you, because I don't care if you want to, what the numeric value is of what you're trying to scale. But in my opinion, if I only wanted to ever have 20 clients, I wouldn't start a business. Like if I only wanted to impact 20 humans, I probably wouldn't start a business. I would say you're going to spend a lot of time trying to build traction on social media and get the client acquisition, right? So, you know, if you're somebody that's listening to this thinking, you know, I don't know where it's going to take me, but I know that I don't want to work a 9-to-5 forever. I know that I want to replace my income. Like if that's kind of what you're thinking, then you're looking at a 6-figure business. You're looking at strategy that you don't have right now. You're looking at a consistent lead flow, because I can promise you, if Lauren loses a client, she's got another ready to go, right? Like there has to be this fulfillment that we create. So yeah, that's why I think the 3-hour workday is something that just really drives me nuts, because entrepreneurship is so hard. And I think that we stray away from saying that. And there are coaches that do say that, right? But when we think about the ads and the messaging, it looks so luxurious. And I, you know, somebody asked me, and I'll ask you this, Lauren, but somebody said, if you knew everything you knew today, like going through your entire journey in entrepreneurship, all the ups, all the downs, whatever, would you do it again knowing what you just went through? Yeah, I did too. Like it was so easy to answer. I was like, absolutely. So
no, you know, there are definitely days where I am like at my wit's end, you know, and
totally.
There are absolutely days where I question, because I'm someone who I got a lot going on up here and there's like, you know, and I think to myself, wow, wouldn't it be nice to have, you know, a more stable kind of thing. Right. I definitely think that, but then I always revert back to, no, I clearly am doing this for a reason. And I always have like, there is like this deeper why that I know what I want to do. And that is what drives me, you know? And it's like, okay, I'm going to, you know, I feel like I have to fulfill almost like a duty, right? And I actually really like the point that you talked about with the 20 client thing, because I never really thought of it in that sense. But that's also, that really speaks to, hey, maybe you want to work with less people, right? That could also be a great thing for then you to work with a company, to work as an assistant coach, to work with, to be an entrepreneur, because not everybody has to be the person who runs their own business. That is where like teams are built, right? And now we can definitely get into the whole team dynamic for sure, because there are definitely pros and cons to that, no doubt. But there are a lot of great teams to where, hey, if you vibe with like their personality, their coaching style, all of that, like that might be better for you, because then that's the thing where you can control. And again, every team is going to have a different, you know, like layout, right? But like overall, you could work with less people and have less of that risk if you're willing to do that, versus like you said, the whole client acquisition, like that's like so much of it. So for the coaches starting out, kind of need to put their blinders on a little bit with some of those messages. And the word luxurious really, really stuck out there, because yeah, it's one of those things where people think automatically, you know, you are just like rolling in money and like that is like the life and all of this. It's just like, again, there are probably other ways that you could do that faster. I don't know, but like a service-based business doing that for a few years, like I don't really know a lot of people who are all of a sudden just like, you know, insanely wealthy, right? Like it is going to take time.
Well, they're smarter
to build that.
About it, right? Like if you're insanely wealthy, you're also saving and investing more than anyone else you know.
Yes, that is. People don't like to talk about that aspect. You know what I mean? Like they think that it's like just making money and spending it on things. It's like no, like people who are actually really generally well off are saving money, are investing, and not everybody can do that at every point in their life. Like there are ups and downs to that, absolutely, depending on, you know, the cash flow that you have. But that is how those types of you know, individuals that you're probably thinking of, like that's how they've built other things. But so say like someone is starting out and they are, you know, like you mentioned in the beginning, I want to come back to that. Social media is totally different now. I mean, even like I built my social media. I started in like 2013, I think, when I first started posting, right? Like back in the day, like when that was like fitness Instagram was like starting off. And I mean, good God, I used to post horrific things, right? But you know, part of it, I think it was horrific now, but I also know that part of it was like I was just like super unfiltered. Like I literally said whatever. Kind of like how I talk in person is how I used to be online. And part of me thinks like maybe I should get back to that, but side tangent. So I used to just put up whatever, right? And that's when we didn't have stories. We didn't have none of that. So you used to just post stuff that like could have been a story now, or maybe not even a story. And you would like post that on your page. So I built my following during that time, and also while I was competing, right? So like that was kind of like when I was very heavy in that whole scene. So now, even though I have a decent following, it's does not nearly have the engagement. I used to have more, way more engagement when I had less followers years ago, you know, and that's again part of the algorithm stuff. So even if someone, maybe someone who has built a following, but now it's not reaching as well, or they have a small following and it's again it's not really reaching as well, that can be a huge turnoff for people because it's really hard because you're like, am I talking to no one? Like, what's going on? So, for coaches who are just starting, or maybe they're kind of in a lull point with this, like, what would be some recommendations that you would have there? Because again, there's so much bad information on what to do there, or just conflicting information, right? So, what have you found has worked with clients?
So I'll start with the clients that I get that come from a background similar to you, where they have a large following, no matter when they got it, but all of a sudden they're not getting the reach anymore, right? And so I think it's important to look at what the numbers actually meant. So for example, you know, Lauren, you've got close to 100,000 followers or right around that, I think. You don't have 100,000 clients. Like, not every
No.
follower equates to a client. I think it's important to know that. And so if that happens, typically the coach is telling me, you know, I didn't really have a strategy. It kind of just happened. Okay, cool. Well, like, we can't duplicate that, right? So as things scale, like, whatever you did a year ago isn't going to work today. Like, it's just not, right? And so that could be adding volume, that could be taking note of your utility. But ultimately, what I do, I had a call literally this morning with a client who has 50,000 followers and is now like, where are my clients? I used to have all these inbound leads, and now she's having to actually create an outbound sales strategy, right? We're having to, you know, and I won't discredit what you did, because your content clearly resonated. But now, with the way things are, it's just not getting the same engagement or the same reach. So I focus on what I can control. And what you can control is the conversations that you start and have in your DMs, right? So most people that come from the high following, they're like, I've never DM'd anyone in my life. I just DM who talks to me and who follows me. And that's great. But you can't scale that. Like, you can't quantify that. You can't duplicate that, right? You can't rely on referrals. It's not a strategy. And so that's always the hard conversation, because there's a lot of ego involved with influencers that I meet. They're like, oh, I don't want to do that. Like, all this resistance. And I'm like, sucks to suck. Like, you got lucky. So now let's actually scale that. And not to, again, discredit your coaching skills or any of those things if you're listening to this, but it's just time to now have a strategy for those things, right? And so then the clients who are like, I have hundreds of followers and that's it, or less than 1,000 or whatever the number may be, for you, that's a really exciting place and time, because again, you're not clouded by this idea that like you once had something and don't anymore. So to me, that's more of a clean slate. Number one, do not start a new profile unless you just haven't touched it in years.
I was literally just like, maybe I'll start a new profile.
No, don't do it. Don't do it. No,
I think
don't start
about
a new
this
profile.
constantly. You know that meme where it's like the little stick figures in bed, like, I'm gonna delete my social media. It's like 2 a.m. That's me. I'm gonna delete my social media and like move to the woods. Like
No, I wouldn't do that. But, you know, there's, I mean, based on the client, there's also like certain things that I'll try with them, right? So to see how awake their audience is, like whether that is like hosting a workshop or trying a broadcast channel or doing an email campaign, right? Like, there's other ways that I work with clients just to see like where their audience is kind of awake, right? But again, those new clients or newer to Instagram rather, don't stress about it. Like, the best thing you can do is to reach out to 30 new people a day, 5 days a week, and just bring up your engagement in the DMs, right? And in terms of posting frequency, It really doesn't matter. Now, if you're somebody that has really quality content and you've had a high, like for you, Lauren, I would honestly say posting twice a day may be phenomenal as you're moving forward, because you've had, you almost have to like jog the algorithm that you're still there. It's almost like you hit a certain level and you're like, crap, okay, what now? So to give you perspective, like in 2019, I was posting like three times a day and that felt like plenty. And then today it's 2024 and I'm posting twice a day, right? And reels are great for new eyeballs, but like carousel posts, education, that's really great for your warm audience. So I think we get so hyper fixated on like followers and vanity metrics, when in reality, I've never had a client go viral and really get clients from it. Ever.
Yeah, no, for sure. And I can't remember who I was talking to, if this was on the podcast or not. I've been having so many conversations that I sometimes forget this, but it's a good point. So we're going to bring it up regardless. All the hands.
Same.
With going like viral, right? Like, let's say that someone like has a post that goes viral. I was talking with a friend who's a coach who was talking about another coach, right? This, that other coach, who I don't know, so I can't speak
I'm
to
following
exact.
You. Okay.
Yeah, I can't. I'm like, this person twice removed, they live down the road. So like, I don't know them exactly, but the story was they have posts that go, you know, do very, very well. So they get a lot of eyeballs, they get a lot of inquiries, but like based on those types of like more viral type posts, there might be an influx of inquiries, but they're not serious inquiries, right? And what's so interesting about that is, if I think back to, I'm like, who, like the client inquiries that come in who sign up, right? They're like, yeah, I've been following you since 2015. Or like, I've watched all your YouTube. And I'm like, what? Like, that's crazy, right? But it's like, they get on the call and they're like, hey, yeah, okay, let's go through this, wham, bam, all right. Like, I already got a feel because I've listened to all of these things, right? So sometimes it's not even necessarily about, like you're saying, the likes, because I'm like, oh my gosh, is that person even like, how are they like around still? But like, it's kind of just like in the background of their subconscious. And it is hard. It is an ego thing. Like, it's fucking hard to like put out quality shit and be like, nobody saw this. You know what I mean? Like, everybody hates me. And like, that's kind of what it feels like, unless you post something that's like super vulnerable and like emotional, and then people like come out of the woodwork. And it's like, that I feel like is a tough strategy for me, because sometimes I do want to share things that are like emotional and vulnerable, right? Like, as like a, just as a human being, right? Like, as a person who's like, hi, I run a business, but like, I'm a human. But then it's like, you don't want that to be like the only reason that people are like engaging either, right? You know what I mean? Like, it's like hard, because you want to like, okay, I want to like show that I'm like a human and a person, but I also want to show that like I'm a business person too. So to loop this back into something that's relevant, when you are working with people who are trying to create more of a content strategy, do you like to rely on like, hey, be more of business you, or like be business you plus personal brand you? So like, we're weaving in like weekend stuff, we're showing partners, like we're doing like I love this outfit. Like, are you like, do you want people to do kind of like a mix? Does that make sense?
Yeah, 100%.
Okay.
So I always say, like, you are an extension of your business. Mm-hmm. Like, you are the face of it. So there should never, ever, ever be like, okay, I'm putting my business hat on today. And I find that that's really hard for newer coaches. It gets easier as you keep growing, mm-hmm. but newer coaches are like, oh, okay, well, like, you know, even if you come from a sales background, if you're selling yourself, it feels so different, you know, okay. So different. Like, people always say, oh, Taeler, you were on TV for 10 years. Camera's easy. It's like, yeah, but I was telling other people's stories, not my own. Like, it's very mm-hmm. different. It's a different modality, right?
So, different.
So to your content point and the strategy, right? I always say there's three kinds of content that you should be posting. So number one, you should be a thought leader. Number two, educational. And number three, inspirational. Now, every kind of content, every piece of content should have some kind of a story. Okay. When I say storytelling, I mean, you're relating it back to what a client said, what you did, what you saw, what you heard. When people ask me like, oh, I can't think of any content ideas, the best thing any of you can do is when you get off of a call with your client, or when you finish a check-in, go write down two ideas from that check-in. Literally, because then the content becomes super relevant. So for example, instead of how to get more protein, it's how I helped Katie get 25 more grams of protein in less than 30 seconds in her morning routine. Oh shit, I want that. You know, whatever. I'm just making something up. But like, the more relevant you can get, because ultimately the messages I get in my DMs, when you talk about engagement, you're going to look at my post and be like, okay, this is great content. Why is no one engaging? And I'm like, because people DM me my own content and say, was this to me today? Like, I needed to hear this. That's like my DMs. If I open my DMs on any given day, I've got 40 or 50 unread messages, right? And again, I don't have a large amount of following, but if you think about how many of those are converting, we're moving quickly, right? And so I think it's about really understanding, number one, who you are targeting. I think so many coaches go into this without any idea of who they even want to help. And who you want to help is not busy moms or millennials. Like, it's a problem that you solve. And it can be multiple problems, right? Mm-hmm. But I think getting really clear on that and then understanding how to keep your content relevant, because educational does convert. Like, you have great educational content, but the next time you share something, maybe you think about, okay, did I used to struggle with this? If so, how can I weave in two sentences that relate it back to a struggle for me? So it's not just, you know, a vulnerability spill all at once. Like, there's ways to be mm-hmm. vulnerable without like mm-hmm. making it a huge story.
For sure. No, yeah, definitely. And I just know that a lot of people, I think, can, at least that I've talked to, like, you know, other like friends and also just other coaches, like, do struggle with that line of like, how much do I share? That's like just about me, right? And this is especially hard, I feel, or I've found, when it's also like you're running a team with other coaches, right? Because then it's like, do I talk about, you know, do I put a lot of emphasis into like team content or just like my own content? Because those are different things, right? Like, so for a while, you know, our team was pretty good with their content. Kind of had a falling off point, getting back on track. I'm very proud of myself. We've been back on the horse. And like, even like literally today, before we got on this call, Jill was over and we sat and we planned the idea outlines for, you know, April's team content. Right. And, you know, figured out exactly like, okay, here are like the topics, here's the type of post, da, da, da. Like literally did that. Like, what are the articles going to be on? And like little things. And it takes a few hours. And then it's like, okay, it's so nice to like literally go, okay, what do we have to do like this week? Or, you know, I look ahead for obviously the next week. Like, what do I need to get done? Because I find that for me, it's really easy just to be like, I have 1,000 ideas, but then like, what do I do today? Right. So, but with the team stuff, right, like you can be just more like educational, right? Like if you have a platform, whether it's like, you know, emails or an Instagram or whatever for like the company that you work for or you're working, like that is yours. But let's just say that someone is a, you know, someone's listening either. Let's start, I guess, with, my calling, there's so many ways, so many directions I want to take this. Let's say someone has been, you know, working solo and they've gotten to a point where they're like, all right, I feel like I can't continue to grow the business just on my own, right? When do you suggest they bring someone in? Whether that's an assistant coach or that's any other type of position, right? We'll start there.
I think that number one, a lot of people assume that they need somebody before they actually do. So if you're not making six figures, you don't need a team member. Like, there is nothing to manage. I see people that bring in setters when they're not even making six figures. And I'm like, do you even have leads? Right. Like, and then the setter doesn't work out for them and they're confused, or they hire an
AC.
What
is that?
A setter is like somebody in your DMs. They're setting appointments. Okay. So people might want a DM person, right? And they come in, they quickly blame the setter for not getting appointments on their calendar when in reality, they didn't have a strategy to begin with, right? Or, oh, I want an AC because that sounds cool. I want to build a team, but they don't have the volume to give them, right? So the hiring hierarchy, so to speak, is number one, once you've reached a six-figure component, I would say get a virtual assistant and like offboard anything that doesn't have to be you. So anything that is, you know, client focus is you, and then sales and marketing is you. But that's when you offboard things like your support email, onboarding, contracts, manual stripe checks, KPI tracking, key performance indicator tracking. I knew Lauren would make me say that. Just any numbers,
listen,
you know?
Maybe everybody listening knows this shit, but I am like...
No, I don't think it's common knowledge. We talked about that. Yeah. I don't at all.
I'm like,
no, but it's like, I think a lot of coaches like they want to hire the AC before they want to hire the team support. And I would always get a VA first, hands down. I would get a virtual assistant because, again, there are so many things that I promise you you're doing right now that could be automated or delegated that really don't need to be you. Like, you do not need to make your graphics. You do not need to edit the videos. Now, some of these things are luxuries that, you know, you're going to have to deal with a little bit longer, but your VA can edit the podcast. Your VA can upload the stuff. Your VA can schedule the email. So that's where I would start first, which gives you more time back to focus on client acquisition. Then the second hire that I would make would be a setter, like an appointment setter, right? So once you have clearly created a workflow for, okay, this is how I take a random person from cold to close. I know how to get a stranger to hire me, right? Once you have that documented, then you can outsource that because it's about adding volume. So you can't outsource something if you don't know what you need or how to do it. Now, of course, as you scale, you may outsource things like, I don't know, video editing. You don't have to learn how to do that before you outsource it. But again, if you are making, you know, if you have 20 clients, you don't need somebody on your team yet. Like, save those profits, right? Like, keep your profits as high as possible before you outsource. And then on the contrary side of that, like, once you've got the AC or whatever, you know, if you're looking to hire a business manager or you're looking to go for maybe like a more of an investment for a mentor or whatever, those are investments that the ROI is going to pay off for you. And don't be afraid to make those moves. I always say hire somebody when you're about 70% of the way there. Don't hire somebody when you're panicking, right? Because I think people underestimate how long it takes to hire and find the right person. So especially, you know, like the assistant coaches, right? You may have a client that's begging to work with you or whatever, but usually, you know, don't go for the low hanging fruit, which is the friend. You know what I mean? Like, actually make a job posting, actually post, actually have a formal process. I think so many of us are just like not running businesses, you know, like we have interview one, interview two, skills testing. Like, I am not letting anyone on my payroll until I have really vetted them. And I think that a lot of people hire and fire very fast in this industry. And you'll find that the higher you climb, everything is a people person, right? It all falls back on us, but it's like, oh, the AC isn't performing, the setter isn't performing, the VA messed a deadline, whatever, right? Like, it all is a people problem. And so you don't want to start managing sooner than you need to.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. I think that it sounds really great to like have a team, right? But you really have to recognize, like, do you want that? Because that is a very different ballgame than just coaching clients. And one of the things just with business in general, and I hope everybody is taking this like from this podcast, is that it really is an individualized thing, like that you want to make it, right? Because there are going to be different people that, like, everybody listening is going to have a different feeling for like what they want for their business, right? Like, wow, it sounds really great for me to like work with a like small amount of people in like a niche way, and like we handle this and like this is awesome. There's other people who are like, no, like I want to scale really, really big. Some people are like, I don't want like anybody that I'm managing, like at all, right? And then some people are like, no, I want a whole team. Like, that sounds amazing to me to build a team and a culture. But like, that is not an easy process, you know? And there have been many times I have absolutely fucked this up royally, like beyond repair, not beyond repair, but in a really bad way, because I'm good with people, but I'm not good with business and people always. I'm just being honest, you know, it's just not, people are my skills, not always business and people together, right? So I have made a lot of critical errors that have been hard for me and hard for the people who have been involved, you know? And that is, you know, being a human, and that's learning and that's growing. But I do think that it's important to be realistic with yourself. Just like when, you know, if you are working, like say you're an individual and you want to have partnerships, right? Or brand deals or sponsorships, whatever you want to maybe call it. There are things that you have to do to uphold that, right? So there comes a time and a place where you have to decide, like, are these things important for, like, is this like important for my time to be dedicated here? Or should I be using this to build my business? Or are these things just like synergistic and then it's like easy to interlock them? Great, right? But that, like, everybody has to decide for themselves. And I feel like so early now, there is just like this like really unique pressure to create a team that like never really was there. Like when I first started coaching, and not even just when I first started, but like almost up until just a few years ago, I feel like it was very common just to have like individuals coaching, you know, and there were, when you thought of teams, you thought of like the fucking ass fuck teams who like were all the competition prep people who, you know, like it was, you know, the tilapia and two noodle plan team. Like that was not like that was like the extent of, you know what I mean? Like that was the extent of it.
Not the two noodle team.
Not the two noodle, like, bro, literally some of this shit used to be wild.
No, I remember. I know exactly what you're talking about. I like feel like I know who you're talking about. Like I
Of
can think of
course.
names.
The three squeam team, yeah, like that whole kind of vibe, right? Like people be out here wearing three squeams at a time. Come on. For anybody who doesn't know what that is, that was like the waist trainer type situation. But anyways, so up until, I mean, honestly, recently, like the whole team thing was not really as prevalent. And now I feel like if people are starting or getting into online coaching, or they are trying to build it within the past few years, there is this expectation of like, you better have a
You know what I
VA
think happened though?
be doing this. And but like, I don't know what the, I'm like, I missed the whole boat. I was like,
I feel
I
like here's what happened. Okay.
don't know. Here's what happened. 'Cause you're in it.
Here's
So
what I
like, what's
think
going
happened.
on?
This is my take that is so not official or
Hot
backed
take.
up by data. But I feel like we have hit this point where all of like the cool coaches on the internet, like the big names that we think about that really blew up between 2014, 2018. They reached this point where they realized their business was a shit show, and the only way to streamline and organize their client load was to hire ACs. Like, I think that's what happened because I'm thinking of this generation of online coaches, which was the first wave, like the wave that you were part of, right? And I think of working with Lane and Cliff, and like, there were no apps, there were no videos, there were no any of that. It was like bro AF. There was no sales page or landing page or sales call. It was like send a checkout link, that's it. You know what I mean? And that's fine. But even Cliff is now getting ACs. Like he's building a team and he said he would never do that years ago. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, I've just watched all these big name coaches who come from that bro background, and now they're building teams. There's nothing wrong with that. But I also want to say on the other side, this may not be your platform, but I see a lot of clients that I get, they may not be in that bodybuilding, like that old school bodybuilding space. And there's this big push also to make a course tomorrow. Everyone has to make a course. Everyone needs to create a course. And that's what I'm seeing. Everyone has to have a mastermind or mentorship or this and that. Like just focus on doing your thing because the second you start to add new offers before you create maturity for your singular offer, you're losing your audience. Like it's so hard to create a second offer and like really scale that. Speaking of that, like please don't make an app. Like just don't do it. You don't need a $29 app, okay? Like if you can't sell your high ticket coaching, why is a $29 app going to convert? It's literally not. You're gonna waste your time. Like
I think apps are that type of app is great for like true influencers, right? With
sure,
big
different web.
followings who are not looking to do really one-on-one coaching. You know what I mean?
Correct, correct.
I think that, but if that's not you, which I don't think that's really anyone listening here. I mean, I don't know. Let me know. Let me know in the comments. But I genuinely like that's not generally the vibe of the, you know, the feedback that I get from people who are listening to the show. And that's just not the reality is that's not most people because there's only a handful of those people, right? So if that's your platform or that's what you want your platform to be, cool. But if we're talking about, you know, coaching, I think that it's absolutely not necessary. And I love that you brought up like the course thing and then this thing. And I mean, holy shit, like I'm running my second round of my like small group mentorship, right? And I thought to myself, oh my gosh, who am I to offer a coaching mentorship? And then I'm like, okay, I've been doing this for like a long
Yeah,
time.
stop that.
like that, but that literally was like my thought. Like, I can't do this. Like, I'm such a, like, bro, okay. You know, you're coaching just a few people. Like, it's okay. You're making a positive impact. And it's not a, there's nothing business involved. It is truly just coaching, which is my jam, right?
Lesson one is what is a KPI? So you'll learn that from learning first up.
First lesson. Hey guys, I don't know how to work this online thing. I'm just dying laughing thinking about what you're saying with Cliff because as someone who has worked with Cliff for many years and you did too, our updates were, I don't know what he does now. I gotta reach out to Cliff. I don't know what he does now, but
Let's get Cliff on here. Let's three-way him in.
he would be like, so he'd be like, hey guys,
Hey, guys.
so mad. No, he's the best. The most,
Yeah, he is.
we are the most polar opposite. Actually, both of we're so polar opposite to him,
Yeah.
but it's great. His check-ins were just send me an email on this day. I'm like, there's no sheet, like there's not even like a check-in sheet. And he's like, nope, just tell me what's important. I'm like, oh my God, this
Yeah,
is the
literally.
most.
That's so funny. I haven't thought about that in so long. There really wasn't a sheet. There really was not a sheet.
No, at least like with Lane, there was like, hey, there's a Word doc, fill this out. And then with Cliff, it was just send me an email with whatever you need.
But stay in the same thread.
Stay in the same thread. And I think now to what I do, like I literally am so old school. Like I literally use a Google Sheet.
Oh,
And every
I never used an app in my fitness coaching either because those were my mentors. You know what I
yeah.
mean?
And everybody notoriously, I mean, I literally have people who ask me that all the time, and I'm like, listen, like until I see an app that has every single thing that I want, not doing it. You know what I mean? Like in terms of check-ins, right? We have an app like platform for like our training, and there is actually a nutrition component as well, which is separate from coaching, but that's not where I do my check-ins. You know what I mean? So like if until I find an app that I can do check-ins on, that check every single box that I want, we're gonna do it the dinosaur way. And to be honest, like that's fine because that's who I am as a person. You know what I mean? Like I'm not gonna
I
go out
mean,
of my
why
way.
fix something if it's not broken? Like, there's no, there's, you don't have to have trainer eyes or EverFit or any of these other things, you know?
And if you do, like that's great. But speak a little bit more to the course thing and like kind of like and the mentorship. Like there is this pressure that like so quickly people need to do something else. When it's like where do you feel like that's coming from? Like, do you think it's just
Watching people like you and people they look up to, truly. I mean, not that like you, not that you or Jason or any of the other coaches are creating something negative, but I think that we mimic who we look up to. And so I think that if you're comparing yourself to Lauren, you're going to feel imposter syndrome. If you're comparing yourself to Lauren, you're going to think, oh, I need a mentorship. I need something else. Oh, and I need ACs too, right? Like if you're comparing your day 30 to someone's day 5,000, like we have a problem. So, but I don't know where this like, mentorship, not even the mentorship. I think it's the fact that so many coaches are now offering like skill set based mentorships. But what I'm seeing is coaches will hit their first 20 clients and they'll be like, okay, I'm ready for a course. And I'm like, why? We just need to like keep growing the roster. Because I hear often, like more than I'd like to admit, a lot of clients I work with are I think I only want to have 30 clients. That's really it. I'm like, well, what did we? Why did we just hire that person? Like we spent so much time getting here. Like 30 is not that many, right? They're so quick to like want to just build a passive offer or whatever that is. And like, let me tell you all, you're not building a passive offer unless you're making a crap ton of money, because I don't think anyone understands truly what passive income looks like and how much ad spend is required to truly create a passive profitable offer. So, you know, to give you perspective, like I have a course, obviously, but the hardest part about building something new, whether it's a mentorship, a course, second offer, is that you have to be able to withstand a lot more workload up front to build a runway to launch that offer, right? So I remember having about 75 fitness clients on my roster when I launched my course, knowing that I wanted to be okay if some people dropped, right? And I didn't want 75 clients, but you know, it is what it is. Now, I also was making a pivot to business coaching, which was also crazy because I had built this massive audience who knew me for fitness coaching and not business. So I remember the first time I mentioned like money on my story, I was like, oh my God, I feel like an imposter. This is so crazy. This is awful. Like, who am I to say anything about this? So I also think that's important to note is that we all feel that. But if you're having this idea that you need something different, all I ask is that you make it make sense. So typically, if you're wanting to do something different, what I would recommend is master your first offer and get to a quarter million with one singular offer. That is it. Like, get to a quarter million. If you're charging an adequate amount, that should be 40 to 60 clients, depending on what that looks like. Maybe 30 if you're charging a high ticket rate, whatever it is, right? And then at that point, decide, do I want ACs? If I want ACs, maybe I create a 4-week group program that funnels into my one-to-one. That makes more sense. Then I can kind of fill my AC rosters or run a scholarship or a challenge or whatever the hell, right? But if you're like, I want to create a high ticket $5,000 course or something that's totally different, please just have someone guiding you for that. That's all I'm going to say. Like, just, I don't know, have some guidance.
Yeah. And hopefully it's like so uniquely different that it's like going to like do well. Cause if that is the case, then right, like that could be something that would be like, could blow up, you know? But as we've talked about in the very beginning, like a lot of things are just really saturated right now in like pretty much every area, you know? And this is also, again, just because you have a course or something that seems a little bit more passive, like there's a lot of work on the front end and not as much on the back end. You also have to recognize, okay, do I want to do the, like, it's not just you launch it and then that's it, right? Like you said, there's so much more that's involved that's like different now in terms of like the passivity, but it's like the ads, the this, like there's just a lot of other stuff that's going on and it's totally changing the business. And that could be taking away from your like clients, right? Which again, if that's what you want to do, like that's fine, but you really have to be able to manage like what do I want to put all of my effort towards? And I think this especially gets challenging, like again, like with the team, because then it's like, okay, like what, like there's all these, if there's too many offers, that's confusing to people, you know what I mean? And you always want to have some choices, right? Like, you know, the power of three or whatever the hell that's called. I do feel like that's really helpful, right? So people have like options, but they're, you know, there can be options, there can be levels, but like too many that are conflicting, it's kind of like, whoa, 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 like what's going on? Speaking of ads and things like that, I think that's another thing that is so misunderstood, and mis like, I don't know, discussed. So like, let's just ads. How do you feel about that?
Okay, so
take it and run with it.
Okay, so I built a seven-figure business without ever running ads. Let me first put that disclaimer out there. Because I didn't want to spend money on that. I knew that there would be a time to run ads, and that time has been in the last like 8 months or so. And the way to stay ahead of saturation is to dominate the market and to outspend your competitors. Like, I'm just being transparent with like where I'm at running a business. And so if I have more capital than my competitor, then I can outsaturate and I can win. So as long as my product is kick-ass. If you are just starting out and you are thinking like, oh, let me boost an Instagram post, please don't. It's not going to do anything, because for ads to be successful, you have to be so ready to get dialed in on all of your email sequences, on your landing pages, on your framework. And then also you have to be good on camera. People need to watch your ad, and actually you have to have a good playthrough rate, right? And I think being really, really prepared for analyzing that data on a weekly basis. So like every single Monday, I'm looking at my ad data, my ad spend, I'm refilming, I'm reshooting, I'm changing things. Like, it feels like a part-time job, ads, like truly. And that was my goal of 2024. I'm like, I'm going to be a master at ads. Like, I'm going to be a master by the end of the year. Now, every now and then I get clients where they're at a place where they have some capital. We can toy around with some ads, things like that. But truly, I would say 95% of my clients truly are all organic, all the way to seven figures. Most of them don't need anything else. And so I am not anti-ads, but ads are not a quick fix. Ads will get you leads faster. However, if you can't, LOL, if you can't qualify them, these damn like Google things, if you can't qualify the leads, you're screwed, right? So if you're like, oh, I got leads, what do I do with them? Like, you have to be good at sales to make it work. Now, organic is slower, but there's way less risk involved and it's more reliable. So again, take your pick, and that's kind of my take on ads.
Yeah, and I think that's great, because I think there are so many people who, again, are just seeing a lot of different, think about like our clients come to us, right? And they're like so confused because there are so many different like competing ideas, and there's so many competing different diets. Like, you watch one person and they're like, broccoli fucking sucks. And then you're like, what? And then the other person is like, oh my gosh, if you eat any meat, like you're going to die tomorrow. Like, and I honestly, like, I know that sounds really like crazy, but I actually saw a video of somebody saying that like broccoli is like a terrible thing to eat, right? Like,
I see that often.
That's where we're at on like social media and food, right? So I also feel like that is where things are at with not going as bad, but there are a lot of things with like business coaching that prey on like vulnerability and like emotions. And that's actually one of my I found this out because again, like I run things very old school. Like if you sign up for a call with me, it's me. Not saying that's the best way or the right way, it just is. So I don't, there's a lot of dynamics that I don't understand with certain people's businesses, right? But I've heard that there are people who literally have people who are like completely unrelated who do their calls and whatever, which okay, if you decide to do that, that's fine. But that literally are like pressuring people and like making them feel like so like emotionally bad so they like buy something. And it's like, that's not like, that's horrible. You know what I mean? Like, yes, do you need to like bring out emotion? Like, absolutely. But do you need to like bring someone down to like this place and then like all of a sudden just be like, yeah, and I'm like, our thing is like gonna fix this. And it's like, I don't know. I just, there's a lot of tactics that are just very unsavory to me. And I feel like there's already like, if we really look at the space as a whole, there are a lot of very vulnerable people who are coming to nutrition coaches because let's be honest, like they have gone through the ringer with a lot of different issues, whether it's issues with previous coaches, whether it's issues with like their body or, you know, whatever it might be, or both. So they're coming to you often in this really like vulnerable emotional state. And then to like take advantage of that is just, I feel like just terrible, right? So I feel like in the business space, I feel like people are just being bombarded with these messages. And a lot of coaches are just kind of like, what can I do? So I really hope that a lot of this helped. I know we covered a ton of different aspects, you guys, but I knew we would. I was just kind of like, we're just gonna start and then just like go with it. So I feel like we'll probably even do like a part two because there will be, I'm sure, more questions from this. And I would love to have you back on because you're just great. So if people do want to follow your great content, where can they find you? And also just talk about some of the, I know you have a few different programs, so talk about them.
You can find me at Taeler Fit. My name is spelled super weird, so it's Taeler and then Fit. I don't think I can ever change that handle. Like I just, it has to stay forever. It's just been that way. It's is what it is. But no, I have two current offers. So number one, I have tons of podcast episodes and resources as well. Let me first say that because I'm not here to like shove something down your throat. But like I said, I've got a mentorship for coaches that are just starting out that are trying to build that six-figure foundation, as well as high-level consulting for clients that are scaling past that mark. So that is me in a nutshell, though.
Awesome. Well, thank you for coming on. Appreciate it. My favorite fellow emo Doc Martin wearing
I will always be in Doc
sister.
Martens. That is, yes,
Dude.
19 pairs. We've got to get the 20th.
Dude. Yeah. What are you gonna do for the 20th? Oh
I don't
shit.
know. It needs to be like a special pair, though. It needs to be a special pair.
I think it does because that like you need to wait for like some like limited edition drop,
Yes.
like something crazy. No boots until that. So
I'm with you.
till limited edition. All right, girl. Well, thank you for coming on.
Thank
Thank you guys,
you.
everybody, for listening, and we will talk to you next week.